Hello everyone, my name is Daniela Ghica from the National Institute of Materials Physics in Bucharest, Romania. Although EPR spectroscopy has a large variety of applications, I will present today only some applications of the solid-state EPR in materials science, which is our main research activity. I will start with a few words about paramagnetic point defects and their importance as a motivation for solid-state EPR investigations. Then I will present some EPR results obtained in our group on single crystals, powders, and nanostructures to fit the topic of this specialized course and also of our recent research activity. I mentioned here that understanding EPR in single crystals is mandatory for the EPR study of nanomaterials. EPR spectroscopy investigates point defects which are paramagnetic, and I will give you some important examples. The simplest intrinsic paramagnetic center is an electron trapped by an anionic vacancy, the F center. You see it here in the cubic structure of sodium chloride. The properties of the color centers in different crystals have been intensively studied by EPR for many decades. Other important paramagnetic point defects are transition metal and rare earth ions with specific state of the charge state. They can be localized, substitutional, or interstitial in a lattice, EPR being able to distinguish between different localizations. But how point defects are produced in materials and why are they so important? There are several methods to produce point defects, and I will insist on synthesis. By synthesis, very often a material contains native impurities, mainly from precursors. As EPR is a very sensitive technique, such impurities can be detected even at very low concentrations, even below 1 ppm. This information is very important as impurities can change the material properties. This is why doping is one of the most important approaches to search for new material properties, and this is one of the main research topics in our group. These are different examples of materials that we study by EPR. The samples can be in powder form, like this one and these two, single crystals or thin films on a substrate in different quantity for experiments at specific microwave bands. And these are typical sizes. All these samples contain native impurities or dopants. Doping materials started to be of high importance since it was observed that impure silicon has different electrical properties in the 40s. So the first PN junction was created, leading to the first portable devices in the 50s. Soon after, diode lasers appeared, based again on doped semiconductors. Since then, portable devices become smaller and smaller. Solid-state lasers are also based on doped oxides, mainly aluminum oxides. The laser crystals have different colors due to the different nature of the doping ions, and also this leads to specific wavelengths of the laser effect. You see here the nice colors of the sapphire gems with different impurity ions, while the undoped sapphire is colorless. We also use such material as a substrate in the study of the thin film properties, and I will show you an example in this presentation and also in the practical session. And after these nice examples of the major doping influence on the material properties, it is time to go to see few results of EPR in doped materials from single crystals to nanostructures. And I will start here, as you see, with a strontium chloride single crystal doped with iron. It is a cubic crystal which could easily accommodate dopants in substitutional or interstitial position due to its fluorite structure, with alternating filled and empty chlorine cubes. Iron 2 plus is not EPR active. It's an EPR silent ion. But when we irradiate at low temperature, we produce paramagnetic iron plus and iron 3 plus ions, which we expect to have cubic symmetry, like the crystal symmetry. However, we observe by EPR several paramagnetic centers which have non-cubic symmetry, as I will show you later. I will discuss here the properties of the iron plus centers, and I will start with the iron plus one center, these two lines. A system with electron spin 3 halves should have 3 fine structure EPR lines. But when this 3D7 ion is placed in a cubic crystal field with a strong axial distortion and we apply a magnetic field, we observe only one EPR transition in X band. Still, we observe 2 lines which can change position if we rotate the crystal in a magnetic field, like in this figure. You see here that there are 3 possible orientation of a tetragonal defect, 1, 2, 3. When we rotate the magnetic field in a 110 plane, 2 of them became magnetically equivalent, and this is why we observed 2 lines producing this specific pattern. DPR parameters have been obtained by fitting this pattern using the appropriate spin Hamiltonian. Moreover, on this specific line, we observe a super hyperfine structure, which is perfectly simulated considering 8 equivalent chlorine nuclei. And the principal values of the super hyperfine tensor, which was determined by ENDOR. ENDOR is a combined EPR and NMR technique, which we use to investigate the nuclear interactions of the first order neighboring chlorine nuclei. The structural model of this paramagnetic center was established based on this data and contains 2 native impurities, 1, 2, which produce a strong axial distortion and a stable defect with high symmetry. So tetragonal symmetry along a 100 axis. So we are looking again at the EPR spectrum, and we concentrate now on these 2 intense lines, 1, 2, which have smaller satellite lines. Their angular dependence is here. And the G tensor principal values are here, demonstrating that we have tetragonal and monoclinic symmetry of the two related centers. Of course, for a lower symmetry, there are more inequivalent orientations of the defect, and we produce more EPR lines with complicated patterns in angular variation. For this center, we have also observed a super hyperfine structure, which in this case was simulated by considering only four equivalent chlorine nuclei. This is consistent with a square planar tetragonal symmetry, leading to an effective spin 1/2. This EPR results also were validated by Endor, which resulted in this structural model, where the iron plus ion is moved from its initial position almost in the center of the square formed by four chlorine ions. This structural model suggests a less stable defect. About the thermal stability, we performed pulse annealing experiments and we demonstrated a higher stability for the defect where the iron ion is stabilized by two symmetrical impurity cations. So with these examples, we have shown that a lot of information can be obtained in single crystal EPR experiments. Now we see what happens when we measure a collection of small single crystals. These are pure cubic boron nitride single crystals, but they are not colorless, they are not transparent, they have a nice amber color, and we expect the origin to be a color center or an impurity, which we expect to see it by EPR. One single crystal has a too small volume to be measured in X-band. Adding several crystals in the sample tube, we observe a powder, a polycrystalline EPR spectrum, which is a single broad line. And from the line shape simulation and deconvolution, we suggest the presence of two different defects at high and low temperature. So, two different defects. For a better spectral resolution, higher microwave frequency is needed. And I show you here how we selected one single crystal with well-defined facets for W-band measurements at a 10th time higher frequency. You see it here. In this case, the low temperature EPR spectrum shows indeed the presence of two centers, one with isotropic lines and one with anisotropic lines, producing this specific angular variation pattern. So in this case, we obtained a good spectral separation of the EPR lines at higher frequency, but no hyperfine structure was observed in this case. Therefore, a unique structural model cannot be assigned to these paramagnetic centers. And I will show you now an example of identification of native impurities in a single crystal based on the hyperfine structure. Gadolinium 3 plus ions were identified at low temperature due to the specific hyperfine structure of the two isotopes with nuclear spin 3/2. They give this four-line structure with specific splitting and intensity according to these rules. Of course, the central intense line comes from the isotopes with no nuclear spin. We have here another example, the EPR spectra of manganese 2+ ions in zinc oxide single crystals with different orientations in the magnetic field. When the C-axis is parallel with the magnetic field direction, we recognize the fine structure consisting of 5 groups of lines. And each group contains 6 hyperfine lines. From such angular variation, it is possible to determine the structure of the paramagnetic center. In this particular case, G and A are scalars. And you can imagine this is a simple angular variation. If G and A are tensors, it becomes very difficult to imagine what is happening in the first sight. When the material is in powder, less information is obtained, especially if disorder is present. If disorder is high, or if the order parameter goes down to the nanoscale, the fine structure is lost, and we observe only the central group of the lines. This is the case for nanostructured materials. Here you see the 6 hyperfine lines of the native manganese 2+ ions in zinc hydroxide. The hyperfine splitting measured as the separation of 2 EPR lines chemically identifies the host lattice. So if the simulation with the spectral parameters of manganese in the single crystal matches the experimental spectrum, we demonstrate that indeed manganese 2+ ions substitute for zinc in zinc hydroxide and also in zinc oxide obtained by thermal decomposition. In this way, we use paramagnetic ions to probe phase transitions. So paramagnetic ions are paramagnetic probes. As EPR is very sensitive, this method is used to determine with high accuracy the temperature of the decomposition start and also when it is completed by doing pulse annealing experiments. And now I will show you how these things change when zinc hydroxide is not a bulk material, but it's a thin disordered layer in a core shell quantum dot structure. In the S-ground quantum dots, we have manganese ions in zinc sulfide. These 2 narrow lines, and then we have manganese ions in disordered zinc hydroxide at the surface, the broader lines. Here we show only the first 2 hyperfine lines for simplicity. Also, you see here the manganese coordination, and we note that in all these compounds, the cations have tetrahedral coordination. By thermal treatment, we change the surface chemistry and observe by EPR a sequential decomposition of the zinc hydroxide towards zinc oxide. By this change of the hyperfine splitting, This decomposition takes place in a broader temperature range than in the bulk. So it is a size effect. This is another example of size effects in zinc oxide nanocrystals, as observed in the EPR spectra of manganese ions in Q-band. The shape of the hyperfine line changes with size. And we made a correlation between the nano size as measured by XRD and the local strain at the manganese environment, measured by the standard deviation of the D spectral parameter. In this way, by EPR, we can distinguish and quantify crystalline and disordered phases containing manganese ions. This result was useful in investigating the properties of the zinc oxide films. In an undoped film, we observed the presence of manganese native ions, which are here in ppm concentration. From correlated EPR and high resolution TEM, we concluded that the impurity ions were segregated at the grain boundaries in an amorphous environment. This is a very important result. One, it is difficult to monitor segregation effects for impurities in low concentration by other techniques. And we can correlate this with electrical or magnetic properties, which could change due to such impurities accumulation in the grain boundaries area. Here you see the concentration effect of the EPR spectra of the manganese ions in zinc oxide thin films. In the nominally pure film, except the native manganese ions, hyperfine signal, we observe another signal, which is present in all samples coming from the substrate. Although we have high purity substrates, EPR was able to detect impurities in the substrate. The impurities, of course, they have ppm concentration, so we can call high purity substrate here. By increasing the dopant concentration, we observe an increasing broad line. This is due to aggregated manganese ions. Therefore, less information can be obtained from spectra of samples with high dopant concentration. So please keep in your mind that 5% doping concentration is high dopant concentration for EPR. This is another example of the concentration effect on the EPR spectra of the manganese ions in zinc sulfide quantum dots. We can observe the line width increase with the manganese 2 plus concentration. For this specific nominal concentrations, you can see the distribution of the doping ions with different localizations. We see isolated ions in the core of the nanocrystal and at the surface layer, and also the manganese ions localized in the intercrystalline region as agglomerated ions. Note that 2% here and 0.2% here are nominal concentration of the manganese ions. The real concentration is much smaller, as the doping efficiency is known to be very low in nanocrystals obtained by wet chemistry. In fact, there are two important issues when doping at nanoscale: efficiency and dopant uniformity. Moreover, for these two specific nominal concentrations, the agglomerated manganese ions give different magnetic properties. They are reflected in the EPR spectra behavior while decreasing the temperature. So, in conclusion, I have shown you different type of EPR experiments which can lead to various information about the paramagnetic impurities in the sample and also about the sample itself when using paramagnetic probes. And with this, I will thank you for your attention.